The best way to feel Tetris in your bones is to make it yourself. This is Cytris, my take on Tetris. It runs on a 24x24 pixel window because it can. Given how much focus Tetris requires though, playing at this scale would cause a lot of Cytris. Cytris, the game. But that's not the only part of this game that causes Cytris. Let's talk about how Tetris actually works. This right here is the Tetris board, or the Tetris grid. It's the area where the game is played on. Normally, this board is 10 wide and 20 tall, and at least that's what Google says. Let's go with 10x20, where each cell holds a number, and 0 means empty. This is how a piece would look on the grid, which is then drawn on the screen. What I did was, I gave each of the pieces an ID number. For example, the T would have the ID of 1. I think I know why that's the first one though. The piece ID start at 1 because 0 means empty. This is how it looks when we place a bunch of pieces on the grid. So these cells hold 1, meaning that this is the T piece. In this case, that ID is only used to show the color of the tile. Well, that's great and all, but like, where are the falling blocks though? Probably on the floor, cause they're like, falling? I guess they wouldn't be falling at that point, but... They're not here because we haven't created them yet, so let's do it. After a bit of research about Tetris, you can see where each piece spawns in and in what rotation. The T piece apparently spawns here. So I made a simple function that takes the piece's ID and gives us 4 different positions. But why exactly 4 positions? Well, I'm glad you asked! Each piece in Tetris is called a Pentomino, which is the name licensed by the Tetris company. Yes, that's their actual name. Their generic name though is Tetromino, which means the shape that you get by joining 4 squares on their edges. There were a total of 7, which also happened to be the pieces used in Tetris. And if you're a total f***ing nerd, you probably heard of pentominoes as well. Those have absolutely nothing to do with tetrominoes because they're made by joining 5 squares instead. And if you're wondering how a Tetris game with pentominoes would be, well, it's not great.
Great news, I originally tried making a pentomino Tetris but it sucked. But I decided to try again. I will talk about it in my next video. But anyway.
Anyway, I do wonder what tetromino means though. Tetra comes from tetra, probably, which means 4, but what does mino? Well, let's see. A tetromino is a geometric shape composed of 4 squares connected orthogonally, so edge to edge. Tetrominoes like dominoes and pentominoes are a particular type of polyomino? Wait, so tetromino is 4 squares and pentomino is 5, but domino comes from 2. Did you know that? It's so obvious, but it kind of blew my mind. The name tetromino was a combination of the prefix tetra and domino. What? The name domino is probably derived from the resemblance to a carnival costume. Despite the coinage of the word polyomino, there is no connection between domino and number 2 in any language? What? That was quite a rollercoaster, wasn't it? Oh well. Back to Tetris and its 4 squares. So yes, each piece in Tetris is made of 4 tiles, so we only need to keep 4 position values for the whole game, since there can only be one piece active at a time. And also, we don't need to track the positions of other pieces because they're already on the grid, so when needed, we can just check the grid. These positions are the active positions, meaning they represent the moving piece. These are used to place the piece on the grid both visually and physically. The cells at these positions aren't actually filled in until the piece is placed, so it's like we're tracking a ghost. Of course, you probably noticed that Tetris is a blocky game. Literally. The pieces fall line by line, and this kind of thing requires a timer. That means the update code, the part that updates the game for each frame, needs a counter. 60 frames per second means this happens 60 times per second. The simplest method here is to do a decreasing timer. So you set the timer to how much you want to wait, basically like a kitchen timer. Now if you set it to 60 and it's decreased by 1 per frame, since the game is running at 60 frames per second, the timer is for exactly 1 second. This is the key for a Tetris game because when this timer hits 0, you reset it back to 60 and move the piece down. Think of it like a never-ending nightmare for the computer, except it does end when you die. In the game, of course. Setting the timer to 60 means the piece falls 1 line per second. Decreasing the number though will make it faster and harder to control. That's actually how Tetris gets harder as you play. But how do we make it actually fall? It's fairly simple. When the timer hits 0, we check the position below each 4 tiles of the piece. If the cells below are 0, that means they're empty, and since the current piece is a ghost, we don't have to worry about collision with itself, because it's not placed on the grid yet. We move each position down by 1. If the cells below are not empty though, or the position is greater than the grid, you guessed it, the piece is officially placed down. And it's important that we place the piece at the end of the timer like this, because that's what lets us do these cool piece insertions in your mob Tetris. Moving the pieces left and right uses the same logic as well, checking for left or right of the tiles instead. Of course, if the adjacent cells aren't empty, instead of being placed, they just don't move at all. You also gotta make sure that the piece doesn't go out of the grid, otherwise something like this will be the last thing you see before the game crashes, or the piece teleports to the other side. Lastly, we gotta be able to rotate the pieces. While this is simple, it can also be the most complex part of Tetris because there's so many ways to do it. The way I did it was...
What's up, friends? It's me, TV's explanation was more confusing than the solution. All we need to do is rotate this by 90 degrees. If we look at the distance of each cells to the center, before and after rotation, we can see a simple pattern. Here's how we did it. Calculate horizontal and vertical difference between the center tile and the other tiles. And then apply the horizontal distance to the Y value. And vice versa. This is so simple, and it works so well.
Well then, I guess we have to talk about the whole point of Tetris where a filled line is cleared. Now this is fairly simple, but I remember it being a huge headache back when I did it. So we clear a line that is completed, right? But how? You can check each cell on the line using a loop, and if there are no empty cells, that means the line is completed. Simplest way to do that here is to count the number of non-empty cells. If all 10 of the cells are full on a line, then the count should be 10. This means that this line will be cleared, so we clear it by setting the entire row to 0, which means empty. Well, something's wrong, I can feel it, just a feeling. Now we actually have to shift all of the lines above down so that there isn't a gap like this. For this, we have to start from the cleared line, copy the line above, and move to the next line where we do the same. All the way until the second line from the top. The last line doesn't have anything above it, so it's all set to 0. Of course, we have to check for multiple lines being cleared at once. Well, that's easy, you can just apply the process above to each line. That's what I did on this project, but that's a bit unnecessary. You could just do it for all of the affected lines, which would be the lines that are updated by the new piece. And that's Cytris, which is Tetris made by me. That's the technical aspect of it, but using a grid like that, it makes it very easy to render in different ways, such as a tiny window that is 24 by 24 pixels. Lastly, something I completely forgot about, this is where I first made the TV logo. Look at that. I guess I made it back then as a little detail, and it was small since I had a very small area to work with. Oh, and you know that feature where you can save your piece for later and skip to the next one? Well, in this game you can do that by pressing the subscribe button.